Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we now come to funding. The funding way and the shopping centers. What makes shopping centers an attractive investment? And how can we make it a more desirable investment class? Where does the money come from? Why should anyone invest in shopping center or real estate here? And what are the risks and likely returns? These and many more questions will be answered by our distinguished panel.
Yeah, so there are two other panel members also who are missing, but I think we still have almost a full house and pretty much representative of the different segments connected with the retail, real estate financing and other segments. It's actually good to note that this particular topic is a subject matter of a shopping center conference. It has been a subject matter of real estate conferences such as GRI or CREDI or any other. But then, as all the members here would agree, retail real estate, shopping real estate is actually more about retail, the art and science of retail, as opposed to a bigger connotation of brick and mortar of commercial real estate, for example. So I will actually congratulate India Shopping Center Conference Images Retail to make this a topic of this conference and possibly every year hereinafter. I'll just give a quick introduction of the panel members. I'll start from my extreme left. Rahul Rai, who's head of ICICI Prudential Investments into Real Estate Funds, who has raised a lot of domestic capital, and therefore he would be able to give us perspective of how the domestic investors and his proud experience of international investors also are looking at this as a segment. Next to Rahul is Tara Subramaniam. She is the managing director and CEO of JM Financials Group's NBFC business. She brings in a deep experience, a long stint with HDFC Limited before, and for the last few years at JM Financial. I've had the privilege to be a colleague, although for a short stint with Tara while I was at JM Financial. Next to Tara is Pankaj Jaju. Pankaj Jaju has been an investment banker for a long, long time, and during his investment banking days, he has dealt with the retail players. He's been involved with an IPO of retailers and also with real estate, having done a number of offering and fundraising for the real estate people. And subsequently, as he moved from Enam, as Enam joined with Axis Bank, he's been at Axis Bank, first investment banking, and then subsequently as part of the strategic partnerships. Next to Pankaj is Nikhil Chaturvedi, who's been part of, who actually wears twin hats, one hat being that of a brand and a retailer, and another hat of being a mall owner. So, he has experience of both as a tenant and subsequently as a landlord as well. Next to him, next to me, actually on my left, is Bhardwaj, who's head of Capital Malls India and Capital Land Malls India, which is basically a private equity fund which has invested into a few malls in India, but otherwise part of a very large mall operator cum owner, definitely in Asia Pacific, one of the largest, if not the largest, and also been present in India for a long time. His prior experience significantly has been in Singapore, but for the last 1 year, he's been looking at Capital Mall India's business into here. Rish Tej, who's a consultant, and he runs his own boutique advisory firm. He has helped a number of developers raise money for across real estate segment, and I believe in the last maybe 1 or 2 years, he's also been involved deeply with raising capital for the shopping centers. So the topic actually covers various factors, but I'll just start with a very broad kind of 50, 60,000 feet kind of a question, and then maybe get down to specific. So the question is that has this sector come of age? And when I say sector, I'm talking about shopping center, and I'm talking more specifically from the point of view of a investor, it being an investment grade asset class. So, has the sector really come of age? It has been through its rounds of triumphs and tribulations and failures and successes and so on and so forth. Earlier in the one of the panels, earlier in the day, somebody actually talked about it's still the early stages and there is still miles to be covered. So if it's still long distances to be covered, my question would be that has this really become still an investment class, or there is still some time to go? Has it acquired enough depth that institutional investors actually start looking at it? And no better than asking this question to Rahul. Rahul first, who does have some kind of an exposure from the past in the retail shopping center side.
I have a mixed view right now. As far as, you know, investing in real estate, we have been looking at it for last 10 years. So it remains a very positive and a promising thing. But as you pointed out, you know, in the morning also, people were saying that the current stage, there is still a little uncertainty on the business dynamics and whether one should invest at this stage or one should wait. I think overall one should invest, but one will still have to be careful about investing. So if you ask me, you know, whether I'm bullish about it, I'm still not bullish. I'm not a very optimist, but I'm also not saying that I will not touch it. So selectively, if it's a very compelling kind of a story, I believe it can be looked for investment. And the reason for that is, if you look at it, it's linked with consumption. And I think if we see in all the other stories of consumption in India, it seems to be picking up, whether it's vehicles or entertainment or so on. So I think it's our negativity of around the last 5-6 years around this retail asset, which is making us circumspect about investing in it. So I will not totally do away with my caution, but at the same time, I will be on a very selective basis. If I find that, you know, it's a good location which will be supported by the retailers, then look at investing. And can also consider, you know, there are a lot of projects which have been going through struggle and are now reaching a stage where, you know, a little bit of money can help it to, you know, start operations and become operational. So those kind of presents a really interesting opportunity, where a small bit of money, you can take a stake and you can be a lot more sure about the success of that particular investment. So that's my pick.
You raised a very pertinent point about the consumption story, and I'll come on that point to Nikhil a bit later, but let's just extending on that question, Rish, actually, I'll direct this to you. You have been dealing with the domestic and the international investors. So continuing on the same question, do you think that the global investors have actually commenced looking this as part of their real estate investment allocation?
Yeah, RK. Actually, it's very interesting because we're seeing pension funds, endowments, and sovereign funds looking at ready malls as a very attractive investment opportunity. In fact, so it won't be like everyone won't be painted with the same brush, but select assets which are well managed, operator owned, where there's no strata ownership. Some of these malls are enjoying trade density growth, double digit, rental revenue growth, double digit. So compared to, like, let's say an office asset, which has fixed growth of about 5% year on year, 15% every 3 years, these assets seem more compelling, and institutional investors are willing to pay a premium, in fact, for shopping centers that are enjoying this kind of growth. Again, it's select few centers. You know, money's chasing good quality assets that are performing. Even the tenants are chasing similar products. So there's definitely consolidation in the market. The strata title owned malls are completely out, but assets which are owned are actually enjoying this attention. Even lenders like Pankaj are focusing on, you know, doing LRDs for these assets. So even if the mall owners do not want to sell them, they can leverage up their assets and look for new acquisitions. The rental, let's say the rents, the rental yields for shopping centers in the same micro market compared to office Some of the micro markets, you're seeing that rents for malls are much higher than office. So it's actually giving mall owners or mall developers a distinct advantage in buying infill locations, you know, and outprice their peers because they can build their malls to higher rental yield compared to, let's say, an office developer. So that's a clear advantage.
Thanks. Nikhil, I'll just come to you. You know, earlier Rahul talked about the consumption story, and in fact, the consumption story has always been there in India. The growing, the big growing middle class, you know, is the story which has driven so many consumer companies into India, and rightfully so. Yes, acquiring that, capturing that may have had its own sets of challenges for different set of people, but that story has always been there. Now, one of the end channels of, and that is translated into vehicle sales, you know, retail financing, mortgages, whatever, e-commerce, whatever you call it. To what extent has the shopping mall actually benefited? And I mean, a lot of this should have been coming through the shopping malls as organized retail grow. But somehow it seems from the experience of the investors that it is not translated yet so much into the ROIs which the investors actually look at. So, you know, is this something that one should continue to look at, and you think that you know, the growing consumption action activity can be captured through the malls and therefore for the investors?
100%. There is no other place to capture the growing consumption patterns of Indian society. And if you actually have a look at how this industry has gone through different phases, you also need to understand the environment. In 2006-07, India was the most attractive destination for retail investment. Our interest rates were at an all-time low of 9%. And it was a very, very attractive investment class to put your money into, because the yields on the assets were at an all-time high expectation of almost 20% plus. 2008-09-10, whatever happened, everyone knows, but your interest rate went from 9% to 14%. So basically, you had a 50% increase in your cost, in this case, which is almost 50% of your cost for the first 9 years. This is not recognized as an industry. We aren't infrastructure. We are considered as real estate, as though we are short-term players. So you need to understand that the environment totally changed. And because the environment totally changed, people lost a huge amount of monies. So for new players to actually come back into the industry, this has become a specialist industry now, and you will find old money maybe coming back. People who have been able to cash out will be very excited about coming back. People who are long-term players may be excited about coming back. But I have very serious doubts about new money coming into this asset class unless it becomes equally attractive as it was in 2006. Indians have a very short memory. The businessmen will change in a 10-year life cycle. So there will be new people to come and make those mistakes. So maybe in 2019, you will find India number one on retail attractiveness. Interest rates will be 8%. GDP growth expectation for the next 10 years will be 8% plus. And everyone will say, we're foolish, we didn't make malls before. So this is all about timing. So you should, if you believe in an industry, you make it in the bad time and wait for the good times to come. If you don't believe, don't be in it.
No, absolutely true. Another question is, Pankaj, I'll direct this to you. Why are we even talking of this topic now? I mean, why were we talking, for example, so much 2 years ago? So what has changed in the recent times, as per you, that you know, people are talking about from an institutional investment perspective of this sector? So has there been any factors which could be regulatory, which could be just the investment allocation or things like that?
So fact is that you know, every investment is attractive at a price, and at different points of time in a asset life cycle, there are those opportunities that creep up. If you look at the long-term opportunity for India, India is a country with 1.2 billion people. We are going to spend more, consume more. Yes, online will happen, but people will need to go out and interact with people, eat, which you can't do online, and generally have a good time. And malls are the place where most of us do hang out on weekends. So reality is that there is a latent demand that is for shopping and enjoying oneself in shopping centers and malls. Now that being the case, the only reason why we've been hit at this point of time is a couple of things. One, that most of the malls that got made were disrupted not by online players but by better malls that came up. So there's a learning curve that the industry has gone through, and like Nikhil said that, you know, 2006 is a time when a lot of money came in and this looked like a very attractive investment destination. A lot of money came without understanding the risk associated with it within India, and even the developers who started setting up malls did not really think deep and enough about what is it that will make the mall last a generation. And people made shopping centers, strata sold them, did not think about how it has to be holistic, what is the mix of products and how will the catchment really come in. Now with all of that learning in place, I think we are all set for the next phase of growth. And the opportunity today, and the reason why probably we are talking about it, is that there are enough and more malls where the developer has made a good product but may be stressed today, and thus there are opportunities for people to come in and buy the mall. The second opportunity is arising because in the last few years, given the fact that the earlier investments took time to get delivered, capital for investments dried up. The risk appetite of developers also dried up. So today if a developer says, I'm going to buy a piece of land to make a mall, his friends will tell him, are you mad? Pagal ho gaya? Why are you making a mall? Go and make a residential building and sell it off. At least you'll get cash flows. And I think that's the biggest opportunity, that the long-term opportunity is alive, but nobody is building new assets. And thus for somebody who wants to really be in the game for the long, there is an opportunity. And that's probably the reason why we're talking about it again.
Right. Rahul, do you think, I know institutional investors have been evaluating it, but do you think that the regulatory change in the FDI, you know, on the real estate side, which happened last year, the regulatory change which happened last year, which allowed practically real estate foreign investors to invest across developed, underdeveloped, you know, fully developed properties, is that one of the trigger?
I think it will help, but I wouldn't call it a trigger. So, to give an example, I think it's just a question of the industry having gone through the pain and now reached a stage where it's once again looking somewhat promising. To give an example, our fund had invested way back in 2008, early 2008, in a mall project. It was the first investment made by our fund. And we are at the end of our fund life and we still have not been able to exit that project because the project is still not complete. What happened in between was we couldn't achieve financial closure. It was an equity investment. It couldn't get debt. It was a blessing in disguise because, you know, if we look at it, if we would have got the debt and if we would have constructed, we would have opened right in the time where the markets were really at a low and the interest burden would have really hit the project. So in a way, we turned out to be lucky for us, this duration of the gap when nothing happened. Now it's looking very promising. We are exiting at a profit and the mall also expects to get operational in next 6 months and likely to be a successful one. So I think this is what is happening in the industry, that, you know, people ventured out, they didn't think through well about the design of the mall, the capital structure of the mall and so on. Everybody went into it. Everybody learned on it. And now that the lessons have been learned, I think people in the next round hopefully will make better investments. And as far as the foreign funding is concerned, I think it's a function of availability of capital. The domestic capital has dried up, so the natural source of this kind of funding is going to be the foreign capital. That's where the regulations does help, because these are all high cost investment and you require a long-term view to hold this kind of assets. So government opening up this sector, completed mall for, you know, foreign investment, people coming on an operating basis, I think is a positive thing and will help the sector.
Bharadwaj, a question to you. Amongst these panel members, you have the maximum investment in the retail shopping centers. So what do you think this, you know, what is it that you look for in an investment? You know, what are the factors that you consider and why do you think it makes for an institutional investor a great investment category, asset class?
I think the most important thing we look at, of course, is the location. Location as well as our growth population and the growth in the particular catchment, because retail is all about primary and secondary catchment. So considering that for us, for foreign players like us, we also need to look at the exchange rate, because that's something which also is important for us, because once we invest, once we want to take back the money, sometimes we lose out on the exchange rate itself. So in addition to that, I think adding on to other point on the FDI, I think the one of the key thing which happened last November was we can actually buy a completed asset which was not available for us in the past. So from November onwards, we can buy 100% completed asset. So that for foreign developers like us, actually one of the biggest risks we do face is the development risk, where approval risk, all this thing. If there is a ready asset where we can actually add value to the to our core mall management scale, as well as the asset enhancement scheme, asset enhancement improvement, I think that's something which we can add value to the asset, which we can bring up the yield from maybe a certain percentage to higher level, which is our what we call as a buy. Since we are operating many malls, we do understand every country goes into different way of growth story. We are operating in Singapore, China, Malaysia, as well as in Japan. Now India is as well, we have presence here. So in that sense, I think retail, definitely there is a, we are looking for opportunities, but I think location is a key for us. Then the first year, second, the first, the primary catchment and the secondary catchment, because we do need to compete with e-commerce, which doesn't have any boundaries. So I think that those are the main key points I have.
Right. And I'll come back to you on some more questions later on the asset management. Tara, question to you. So, you know, the retail sector, shopping centers have been funded by banks and financial institutions, by typical structures of construction finance getting replaced by, you know, lease rental securitization subsequently. But overseas, we see much more structures available. I mean, given the nature of volatility in the earnings, that could be for retailers and therefore for the mall owners, as it's moving towards percentage revenue shares. So as, you know, on the debt side, do you see that banks are, or financial institutions or NBFCs are coming up with different solutions which actually can take care of the mall owner's requirement, one during the development phase, and then the post-development, you know, as he's still trying to stabilize the property for another 2 or 3 years, as the occupancies are still catching up to go to an optimal 90-95%.
You know, on the outset, what I need to tell you is all NBFCs, HFIs, and banks have limited resources. And what all of us would like to look at is increasing the housing stock, which is far more important than increasing retail or malls or destination places. Also, because what happens is with the institutions which are lending, we need, as I said in the morning session also, the biggest risk is the exit risk. In most developers' projects, they are not very sure whether they want to sell the entire thing, whether they want to do fragmented sales, whether they want to do lease. I don't blame them, because as and when the project gets over, now if a developer says it's going to take 3 years, it could be anything between 5 and 7 years when a project gets over, ready for occupation. By then, the LOIs that have been signed by the retail guys, maybe they walked away because some other project has come up and it's easier for them to do it there. So, you know, the tenant occupancy is something which is very, very gray. And that is something which any institution is not going to like. And another thing which I think we discussed in the morning, I don't know whether we discussed in the morning, but we also need to have insurance for the period of time when there is absence of tenancy. And that is something I've been actually talking to a lot of retail guys, that they must talk to insurance companies that if a project has been let out and a developer has taken money, LRD, what happens is sometimes it happens that 20% or 30% of the tenancy, they vacate and go away. the developer is not then able to obviously pay his EMI because he's not able to get the rentals enough. So for a period of 3 to 4 months, the insurance company will have to give him the tenancy vacancy rent. And that would also help, and that's something I think all retail guys or even developers should try and work. You have to obviously pay a premium. I don't know whether you're ready for it. But having said that, at this point of time, I really don't think any institution, financial institution, bank or NBFC is really ready to look at retail.
Right. You're actually right. So no hard, no matter how hard we, you know, as equity investors also look at leveraging on the debt to enhance our equity returns, and besides financing, of course, but it's a little difficult to underwrite.
But having said that, you know what, I've been hearing a lot of people talk about equity. In fact, even Ahul just now mentioned about how they went into a mall with an equity. What I suggest is that when the equity is done by the promoter and the fund, what they should look at is not only the cost of the land. They should take the whole project as a cost, including the construction, including the running of the mall for the first 1 year, or including taxes and maintenance, and the equity should be brought in at that level. If you bring it only for the land and look for construction finance, I don't think that's going to happen.
Absolutely. Rish, as you've been interacting with both the investors as also the people who require funds, what is the kind of return expectation that the investors are telling you? And number one, and number two, and Rahul, you can also pitch in here. You know, are they looking this at this as more of a yield play, or are they looking at it as a capital growth, or is it a combination of both?
So from the investor's point of view, it depends where in the development cycle an investor is coming in. If it's like a greenfield development, the investor would probably want to come in on the same basis as the developer. So I think it's more identifying your partner. And it's not just someone who can build a good mall, but also someone who can manage it well. Mall management is an expertise which is like a science. It's a very select few who can do it and very select few who have done it in the past. And I think you'll see institutional players gravitating towards you know, mall owners and operators who have succeeded in the past with some track record. Also because tenants would be kind of lining up, you know. So if someone like that is launching a new mall, he'll also have some degree of pre-leases or some degree of tenants going with him. They are, you know, going to find out which is the underserved market, go with tenants on board. There will be lenders who will be willing to back such developers with construction finance on the basis of the pre-leases they have. So typically an equity investor coming in on a greenfield acquisition would probably look at 25% IRRs when they're underwriting. Mall developer probably is looking at much higher. Nikhil will be able to tell us more about how he would be analyzing these. But broadly, I've noticed mall developers are more about multiple than IRRs. So if a mall owner is making 2.5, 3x over 5-6 years, and that really boils down to the basis on which they pick up their land basis. And like Tara rightly said, it's also about getting financial closure. So you also have to fund some amount of the construction equity, since lenders are not willing to fund all of the construction, you know. So location, partner, and getting financial closure, you got to get all those elements. So it's kind of a unicorn because there are not that many investors who are getting in so early. A lot of the investors are very comfortable getting into core assets, both retail and office, that are stabilized. And what they're looking at is if they can get in at an 8-9 cap, and the growth in a mall is, let's say, 8-10%, then the capital appreciation takes them to a 13-14, you know, with the leverage. Maybe if they get a 65% loan to value from a bank and they come in with 35% equity, they're making 20% IRRs on core assets. That's a brilliant place to be, you know.
So if you do have deals at 20-25% IRR, as you mentioned, come to us, the funds.
Yes.
But don't go to Nikhil. Okay. He's not going to offer you a product which gives, you know, possibly a 9%, 10%. He already mentioned about 7% or 8%. Anyway.
Okay. When we are talking of exit, one of the points we have not spoken so far is even in the Indian regulation, one of the positive things is this REIT scenario, which has opened up. And hopefully Europe, while we may see a few office REITs coming up initially, in the next couple of years or maybe a bit longer kind of a time frame, but we'll also have a specialized REIT, which will include focus on retail also. So that will provide an exit avenue also for these developments that are taking place. And I think that's going to be very important development for the sector. It's quite positive, and I think that is giving me bullishness about investing in this sector here, that, you know, there will be a platform available where if I invest in a particular retail development and it's successful, I can exit at a much higher profit.
Right. So, yes, you're right. The REIT market would get tested and set, and you know, if there are any confusions around or any inefficiencies around, I think the office market would do that first over the next 1 or 2 years. And in any case, retail assets would perhaps be REIT ready maybe in 2 years' time or something. So, you know, much of the learning of the REIT market would have taken place by then. So on the REIT question, actually, I'll put this question to Bhardwaj, since Capital Mall Trust, you know, in Asia and other parts, does have lot to do with REITs. What's your take on that, Bhardwaj?
Actually, for us, we have already established 3 REITs, one in Singapore, one is in Malaysia, it's all stock listed in KL, one is in Singapore, then the other one we also established a Chinese-specific REIT. So we have 3 REITs which is specifically meant for retail. So considering that, I think if the REIT retail REITs comes into India, I think it's definitely a big advantage, so that retail players like us, at least there will be a proper exit. Of course, it's subjected to much more conditions, whatever it is, but at the end of the day, at least there is a light in the tunnel. So I think REIT is definitely a plus point for this sector, so that at least we get an exit. But having said that, I think office will go first. Then afterwards, I think slowly the market has to, because the in terms of office and the retail, the asset what we have in office is much, much higher level right now in India, then retail is still a small part when relatively compared to the office asset class.
See, Nikhil earlier mentioned about that perhaps there are 40 malls which are investment, you can call them as an investment grade. And then when you actually go and do a transaction, maybe not all the 40 are transactable, you know, the from an invest transactable. When I say transactable, it's more from the agreement between the investor and the developer. So maybe it could be half of that. Is that big enough? And I compare that, you know, vis-a-vis the office. As somebody mentioned earlier in the day, that apparently over 100 million square feet of commercial office space is being transacted or is being talked about, or where there is a discussion between investors, many of them, and developers. Are you going to see that kind of money flowing into the retail side, or given that we are only talking about 20 malls and maybe an average size of 600,000 square feet or 700,000 square feet of these malls, will there really be too many transactions and for a long time to come, or will it be like just 1 year or 2 years of activity and then the sector is pretty much done as far as operating assets are concerned?
I think, you know, I don't see so much money coming into this space. I'm very clear that there will be few players who will come and put in huge amount of capital so that they can create dominance. This business is about dominance. Unlike the office business, there's no stickiness in the office business asset class. So the growth can be very, very marginal. The stickiness in this asset class creates huge amount of power. So you have location advantage, you have stickiness, you have, you know, there are lots of advantages which come with this business, and that's why people are excited about them. But while saying that, I am clearly saying that the future malls in this country are not going to be built on an asset, when you get an asset in, let's say for example, you get a big asset in Worli, and you say, I'm going to build a big mall here. Why would you build a big mall? Because your residential is selling at 45,000 and you can never get 450 rupees per square feet. So the new assets are all going to come up. When you build 100 acre colonies, you want to build huge amount of housing, you need to support it with school, you need to support it with retail. That retail is subsidized by the tax break which you get because you're building the residential, and that's how the new malls will be made. There's no new malls going to come up the way we are imagining. That market is over, and that's why the big funds are chasing the existing assets. So there is no doubt in my mind that these existing assets will become more and more valuable, and the new assets will not come in these, you know, no one's going to go and make a mall in Bandra, and no one's going to go and make a mall in other places. When you have an asset class and you have, let's say, 5 million square feet to build, so you say that now let me take a punt, I will build 600,000 square feet of retail, I'll build this much office and this much residential. The retail will give you losses in the beginning years, the residential will give you profits in the beginning years. So the retail is subsidized by the profits from the residential, and hence retail becomes viable at 67, 70, 75% of the cost. And that's the only model which will work. So there's no model which exists right now, which I believe someone is going to go and build new malls just to get 8%. At Worli today, you'll sell at 40,000 rupees a square feet and 45,000 rupees a square feet. I don't think even Phoenix gets an average rental income of over 325 rupees. So why would you make a 450 crore asset to get a 7% yield? You might as well buy an existing asset. And that's why the existing asset is more valuable. You might buy it at 6.
I think what we need to be very clear is, are we looking at a retail space or are we looking at malls? According to me, mall is a place which is a point of a destination point where a family can spend a whole day. Either they are shopping or there is spa treatment, there is movies, there are outlets to eat, shop of course, children's corner where children can get entertained, or maybe left behind for an hour or two. I think there's a small difference. So one has to see the location, the kind of catchment that you're looking at, the kind of people who are going to be around you, and then decide whether it's going to be a retail outlet or a mall.
Rahul, given what Nikhil said, it kind of hints at that maybe you would have to sacrifice or give up on the short-term return, which is yield, but possibly the long-term, you know, from a growth perspective, that could be coming. Would you agree with that kind of a strategy that typically the investors would be looking at? Or do you think there could be a good yield play to begin with?
Yeah. Yeah, I think this investment requires you to have a long-term view. So, you know, even if, let's say, I'm giving a last-mile funding to a nearly completed asset and the mall is going to become operational in 6 months, or I'm acquiring a completed asset also, I don't think anybody investing right now is looking at 2 to 3 year kind of a horizon. Everybody is looking at it as a long-term, at least 5 years, if not more, kind of an investment scenario. So it requires a very different kind of a mindset to be investing in it. You will remain invested in that location. You will have to work on that because you will have to keep it rejuvenating it. And as Nikhil mentioned, I think the whole thing is that you ensure that you know how to run the mall successfully. So not everybody will be going into mall. Only select developers and investors will go into it with a long-term strategic kind of a mindset. So I would think even for funds like us, it may not be something that will be suitable for a general pool of money that we run. We may have a dedicated investor or we may have a dedicated pool of money which goes into this kind of thing. So investors will be aware of the risk and the advantages that they are going to get out of investing out of it.
Does that pool of capital exist in the domestic market? Or you think that this is more for international investors?
I think currently it's still international, but it's not existing in the domestic market because there are not that many investable assets. If you look at it at a individual level, people like investing in shops in mall if they know that the mall, if that particular shop is successful.
In their individual capacity, you mean?
Sorry?
You mean in their individual capacity?
In their individual capacity, and one can pool it. So, but I think it's not easy to create that pool of money and invest. But people know that, you know, as Nikhil mentioned, that there is a lot of stickiness in retail. So, if it's a successful retail or a mall asset, whatever you call it, it's going to be a highly valuable thing because it can keep on growing. And investors also recognize it. So, but will I stick my neck out currently to create the domestic pool of money? No. I will speak to international investors and I will try to create that pool of assets. Over a longer period of time, I think it's something that one has a pool of assets. It will get into a REIT kind of a thing. And that's where you are likely to get a domestic participation in this.
Right. Bharadwaj, taking off from what Rahul mentioned, so, you know, it is not just investing, it requires a whole lot of activity thereafter. So, frankly speaking, is there a scope for passive capital to be there in this segment? I mean, for example, in the commercial space, there can be passive capital and there has been passive capital, but do you think there is scope for passive capital to be there on the retail side, or does it require more of a engaged and involved investor?
I think my view is if the partner you are going to work with is already have a very good experience in mall management, he has a track record, he has got network of retailers and also the whole value chain of asset enhancement, all this thing. If you want to partner with them, if you want to invest in that scheme of things, I think it's still okay. You can be passive. But assuming that if the partner doesn't have that experience, then I don't think there is any scope for passive investment, because unfortunately the mall asset class requires a lot of active management day to day. So unlike office building.
Nikhil, most of the operators in India, most of the owners, operators, they pretty much do the mall management by themselves. You know, versus possibly in the other markets where there are professional mall managers, and maybe, you know, do you think one of the reasons that international investors are yet to home in, or when they home in, they would increasingly prefer that the management of the property be handed to professional mall managers?
If you take a list of the top 10 owners of assets and companies which own assets, they all have their own mall management companies. What they don't do is facilities management. So normally you will have all these large companies running their entire asset of 1 million square feet or 1.5 million square feet with 5 people. And everything else is outsourced. And I think that's the similar structure which is already operating in India with the big mall operators. Only thing, we keep a lot of manpower, you know, our partner centers in the UK are run with 6 security guards. We have 160 of them. So it just depends from city to city what the need is. But I'm just saying that mall management is a core part of value creation, like the hotel business. So you won't find the Westfield giving their management out to someone. The value of their asset, the yield compression which happens because of how they manage the asset. So whether it's Capital Land, whether it's Westfield, whether it's Into Properties, who are our partners, all of them manage themselves. So I don't think India is going down any other path. So whenever our partners come in, they will say that, yes, we should manage, we'll help you manage. That's what will happen.
But pretty much the local operators or owners, they will continue.
Whether the local operator might say that, listen, you have more expertise, you're handling my asset, anyways, you don't charge me anything, please do it.
Right.
So we might be very happy. But whether you want to give your brand name away might be the question. Management, I don't think anyone argues. Right. If someone can manage better than you, let him do the hard work.
Of course. A question which is pretty much open for anyone to answer. Again, in terms of sub-segments within retail, again, have you come to a level where it's not just investing into retail real estate, but it is investing into large shopping centers, convenience stores, neighborhood stores? Is that going to happen soon? Is that, do you think, happening, or it's still confined only to the big shopping malls? Number one. Number two, is it all only tier one or is it tier two? So owners, investors like Nikhil, yourself, and yourself, Bhadwaj, are into tier two also. But are investors really going to look at tier two? So the two questions, one is different investing into different formats of retail real estate, and two, diversifying and going into tier two markets as well.
So let's look at the fundamentals of the various segments of retail first. And ultimately, if somebody owns property, that property is going to make money if the tenant is making money. And are you getting tenants who are organized chains where they have, you know, 100, 200 stores or 50, 60 stores, reasonably profitable, where you can pool those assets and create a holding vehicle? Investing in individual properties is meaningless for any large investor. And in India at this point of time, given the fact that retail is a difficult business, we don't have the enablers that we see globally, running a small store with a manager running it is extremely difficult. And if you look at most of the retail formats where, you know, in businesses have set up retail, it's the big box or a large format retail where there has been reasonable level of success. But typically in small stores, typically people have moved from running them themselves to giving it out to franchisees. So I'm not too sure whether from a business proposition, a small format retail on its own, whether it's a kirana store kind of stuff or supermarkets, are yet to be profitable. So I think that would be key challenge that most people will face. The second, in terms of tier one, tier two. So at this point of time, I think from an investor's perspective, and I'm wearing my investment banker's hat, when I would go and talk to investors about looking at tier two, they said, well, yes, India tier two opportunity is good, but I don't have the wherewithal of actually monitoring that. And I'd rather put my money into tier one, where, you know, I can put in people on the ground and I at least have an opportunity to put money into four or five assets in the same city, versus getting into tier two where probably, you know, one or two large malls. So if it's Aurangabad, probably your mall is the one which is there. It'll be difficult for a second mall to really become successful. And thus, do I have the wherewithal of actually creating that bandwidth to be able to monitor assets in tier two? And we really struggle to do transactions, forget, you know, yield assets. Even for residential, where you had cash flows which could be taken out after the project was over in 3, 4, 5 years, people just didn't want to touch tier two. So at this point of time, probably difficult.
Would anyone further like to elaborate on that point about tier one, tier two, and different shopping formats?
No, I think by and large, everybody's covered what we have to say. But again, the only thing that I need to say is that, you know, running a mall is really a specialized job. I don't think every developer, every person who thinks he can run a mall can do it. And I think that kind of what he said, you know, need to outsource is what we need to do. And I think a successful mall has to be run not only where the tenants are good, the retail shops are doing well, the building has to be maintained well, and of course footfalls, which translates to larger sales. But again, we must keep in mind that these kind of malls would do well only over weekends or holidays. And with working men and women, I think the challenge is what is going to happen when the e-commerce sets in, and it's setting in a very, very big way. And I don't think we'd have to wish it away. It's not going to go away. I think how to come and be a successful competition to e-commerce is what one has to look at if you want to start a mall.
Yeah, I just taking from RK's question, it's interesting to see that segmentation of, you know, right from a destination mall, a million five kind of mall, down to a neighborhood suburban shopping center, that categorization is taking place, and you know, where a consumer will go to the destination mall on weekends along with the family, but for his weekday groceries and convenience store requirements, he'll go to the you know, neighborhood shopping center. And so getting the you know, the sizing right and getting the tenant mix right is really the critical aspect. And developers are spending more and more time kind of figuring out the product right, talking to their tenants. And it's interesting to see how that segmentation is evolving now as you know, as we go forward. So we're seeing both. We're seeing the large, let's take Noida for instance, the DLF Mall of India coming in, GIP next door, that's like 3 million square feet within a 1 kilometer radius. And it's obviously eaten up the other 500,000 feet malls that are up and are on the way. But interestingly, we're seeing developers build 200,000, 300,000 feet neighborhood shopping centers in very dense residential neighborhoods where they're getting in a large grocery, convenience store, maybe a small multiplex, so that the weekday requirements of the consumers within the neighborhood can be catered to.
There was this point mentioned by Tara on the e-commerce thing, and I could see that Pankaj probably wanted to jump into making certain comments on it, but the related point, so we were, you know, I was involved in a transaction earlier whereby we were buying a multiplex from a multiplex operator. It was a sale and leaseback transaction, and as you would do a sale, as a landlord, basically you would see the ability of the tenant to pay the rent on time. The tenant could be a high quality, you know, grade A credit rated, but at the end of the day, it is that particular asset from which you are getting the rent, whether that would generate enough rent by itself, which has multiple factors. And one of the important factor is, as somebody also mentioned earlier in the day, that is the movie business, and will the screens continue to be the dominant channel for the movie business? And otherwise, if the movie is getting into other forms of media and less on through the screens, then will that screen be, or that particular multiplex be even viable for the operator? And therefore, a concern or a question for the owner. In a similar fashion, Pankaj, if increasingly, let's say, the e-commerce is going to take away the retail sales, purely as an investor, do you think that's something that we should be factoring into our investment analysis or consideration, at least decision making, if you're looking at owning a mall for 10 years, 8 years, 15 years? How do you think e-commerce will play out? Should we be worried about?
So e-commerce is for real. I mean, there's enough and more written about it, and Economic Times, on the front page or page 6 talks about it every day. Reality is that consumer habits are changing, and down to grocery shopping to buying spectacles to furniture, categories that people thought you would want to touch, feel and see before you buy. Now people are buying enough and more. But at the same time, when you speak about multiplexes, and let me pick that as an analogy. So when video cassettes came about, people said that now why would somebody go and spend $100 for a movie ticket, and that's what movie tickets were then. And wouldn't somebody just rent a video for 15 or 20 rupees and see it at home? Fact is that multiplexes have made a big comeback, because it's not just about seeing a movie, it's the entire experience. So we don't blink an eyelid before spending 300 to 400 to 500 rupees on a ticket. And a family of four going out for a movie is a cost of 4,000 to 5,000, depending on where you go and what do you eat during the break. So reality is that both will coexist. The fact that retailers are, e-commerce players are setting up offline stores. So whether it is the furniture players or players such as Snapdeal, etc., which are now toying with the idea of having touch points where the consumer can come, touch and feel, and offline retailers creating online channels. Ultimately, it's about giving the customer what he wants at any point of time. I come from a bank. Now, conventional wisdom would say that banking will move digital because most of the transactions that people can do can happen on a mobile. And if I were to ask a question of how many people would have visited a bank branch over the last 1 month, I think very few hands will go up. And if I were to go 20 years ago, number of people would put their hand up saying, I went to a bank branch last month. But reality is that all banks are adding branches, and there is a need for both the physical and the online channel. Similarly, in case of retail, I would assume that, while there would be enough and more that people would do online, even the offline component will continue to grow, and for depending on the need of the customer and at different points of time, both will be used. So really the jury is out, but my own sense is if people are voting saying that look, shopping centers will be dead or people will now not go to retail to shop, but it's going to be online. I think that's not going to happen.
I just would like to add one more thing that, you know, in the developed markets, organized retail is currently about 85 to 90%. And out of that 85 to 90%, the shopping centers contribute almost 75% plus. So what typically happens in those markets is that because they have hardly got any inflation or hardly 1%, 2%, there is no new channels of retail coming up. If any other new medium comes in, it normally eats into it. In terms of organized retail in India, only 6% is going through the shopping centers in India. We have to go to maybe 50%, and let's say e-commerce leapfrogs and reaches 50%, yet physical retailing has a long way to go. And experience will still count and be very, very important.
Yeah, Nikhil, see, in the Western market, where organized retail basically went through first to the shopping malls, and therefore the shopping malls constituted a large percentage of the organized retail. In the Indian context, the organized retail itself is small, and then, you know, while you were still, the organized retail was still growing at a certain percentage, within that, then you've got this whole e-commerce thing, which is where the question, you know,
I'd like to add one more thing, you know. If you see what has happened on online, see in India, all customers are very discount crazy. But basically what has online done, you know, earlier my wife wouldn't go to Andheri Street Market, maybe the Santa Cruz Market or the Grant Road Market near the railway station. That's where she would find merchandise of maybe 250 rupees or 300 rupees. That's where she wouldn't be seen and she would say, oh, I can't be standing there. What have these online players done? They have come in and they have started giving 300 rupee products within the confines of your home. Your neighbor doesn't know which market you went to. So basically, what have they done? They've replaced unorganized retail. The organized retail, the sales has always gone to the brand only. Now, whether it's Provoke, whether I sell it from here, I still got the sales. Similarly, Benetton got the sales. So it's an omni-channel world. So for brands, it doesn't make a difference. So whom is it making a difference to? Is making a difference to an unorganized player. And I feel that in the future, if they start converting unorganized, what were we doing? We were taking a large share of unorganized and upgrading the customer. What they're doing is at the level of pricing of unorganized, they're providing an option. And I think that is always going to happen continuously.
I'll add to that. Today, a shopping center is actually a shopping, dining, entertainment center. So the online players are competing with the shopping aspect of it, but not with the dining and the entertainment. So getting that right mix, the sense of, you know, the sense of place. A lot of people go to a shopping center just because it's now become more of a cultural hub. It's become a place to hang out. So the dining and entertainment will kind of increase and because of the you know, advent of online shopping, but getting that right mix, getting the, you know, anchor heavy kind of malls, which once they do well, downsize to improve rents. So it's more of an ingenious and ongoing process from a mall owner's point of view of how to keep getting it right in terms of tenant mix, how to include your shopping and dining players to get your footfalls in. And I think that's what's going to be the interesting way forward.
From an investor's perspective, I think, and Rahul, probably you would tend to agree that the model is actually more increasingly on a revenue share basis as opposed to a fixed rental growing at inflation based or something like that. Now that poses a challenge for us to analyze as to what is that, you know, not minimum guarantee, the revenue share increase that we model, which essentially, Nikhil, is linked to the sales growth of the retailer. The sales growth of the retailer, depending on retailer to retailer, is different. Somebody growing at 5-6%, somebody growing at 10% for the same store, and somebody growing at 15-20% also. So how do we actually underwrite? You know, what is the growth that we take? If you take the normal Hindu rate of growth or the inflation, then you're not never going to meet your IRRs. So that's a big challenge. I frankly do not know how one would address that. The challenge is further compounded by the fact that today shopping malls retail mix may constitute, and please correct me, maybe about 15% F&B, some 5% of entertainment, and then apparel and fashion constitutes a large component. But we don't know what that will be 5 years down the line. So maybe if you could answer as to broadly what are the top 3-4 categories now, and what are those top 3-4 categories that you see 4 years down the line or 5 years down the line, and therefore as your retail asset management strategies or mall positioning, repositioning strategies, what is that continuously that the challenge that you're faced with? This question is to the two mall owners that we have here.
Yeah, actually, I would like to draw upon our experience in Singapore. Today, we are building two malls in Singapore. So one of the mall is just beside Changi Airport. It's called Project Jewel, which is actually a total GFA of 3 million square feet. So the challenge is what we can do in order to bring the customers. Of course, in this case, we have Changi Airport has got 50 million passengers per every year. Then we also have a local catchment. So what we have done is actually F&B has to increase, cannot be 15%, because I think as many panel members say that e-commerce is definitely affecting. So because of that reason, we are bringing that what we call as an experiential customer experience so that they can come to the mall. So in order to overcome that, what we have done is we have created a garden inside the whole shopping center. Then we have a 40-meter waterfall inside, which is a man-made. So by doing so, what you are doing is you are actually giving an open environment, which is air conditioned, but you are actually integrating all your retail. So I think going forward, there will be changes. There will be some changes in terms of fashion, how much percentage it can we can allocate in every mall. But I think more important is shopping mall business is a evolving business. You can't just do it for one model, which may not fold for in future years. So you need to change accordingly. So the other mall which we are building is called the IT-focused mall. Right now, we are actually collecting a data from our customers to gather what they want to see in this mall of future. So in that sense, again, we are going back to the lot of customers like everyone here to gather data. Based on that, we do the design. So we are also evolving in order to overcome the threats which is posed by e-commerce, as well as how we can make our mall still relevant to the society or the community which we are building.
I think you sort of answered all the questions, so I don't have much to add, except that in India, the even in Europe, if you see right now, the malls were designed very, very differently earlier. They suddenly realized that now experience is the big thing. There used to be most of the international retailer malls, they used to ask us questions, why do you want food here? That was the sort of questions we've asked. And now within 4 or 5 years, 15 to 20% of their centers are F&B. So what happens is that once you have a center, whatever is the demand, it keeps changing. Customers create demand, and because of that, retailers come in. So your F&B player will realize that there's a huge amount of demand here. There aren't enough supply. They'll come in once they realize. So I think that's a churn which will continuously happen. But for India, I personally believe that we have to keep the expense low because the retailer can't afford it. India expenses are very, very high because we have no social security. 50% of our savings goes into real estate. People don't care about the yields. So it's a very, very different market. And anyways, shopping is considered the most expensive asset class. I don't know why. So you will find a guy who has a shopping center of 50,000 square feet in South Mumbai. I was speaking to him and he says, I told him, what do you think this is valued at? He says, 600 crore. And I said, why? He's saying, boss, 1 lakh rupee foot. So what I'm trying to say is that the conditioning in India is very, very different. So at least I'm focusing clearly on bringing costing down. I don't think I need to give them, let the retailer give the experience, and we work hard with them to make it cost efficient.
Okay, we are almost coming towards the end of our session. Maybe I'll just highlight one cheer point for the sector. So there is this NREV survey. So the 2016 survey for NREV says that the retail sector allocation has moved up to the second position, moving up above the industrial and the warehousing segment. Of course, the first remains as the commercial office. So that's one good news. The not so good news was also that the same survey done in 2015, so every investor said that they are going to increase their sector allocation for 2015, but at the end of the year, their actual allocation was 22% down. So, but hopefully 2016 should be good. Maybe at this stage, before we go to the audience to throw questions at the panel members, maybe if there is any key question which has not been addressed or key point not been addressed, I would urge any of the panel member to possibly raise a point there, or maybe one panel member can ask another panel member a question. And please remember that I'm not a panel member, I'm a moderator, so please don't raise a question on me. This is all good? All right, questions for the audience? By the audience, for the panel members. Okay, maybe not. Then maybe I'll possibly I'll just play that role a little bit and ask. And again, for anyone to answer, otherwise I'll just point to Rish. Okay, so by default you answer that unless somebody else has answered. We would be sitting in a similar panel next year, and how different do you think that next year would be purely from a retail real estate investment perspective? And would we be still talking the same way as we talk today, or would have more action would have taken place and we could be talking at a different level?
I think it'll be very, very different. But I'm just basing my assumptions on the macros. In 2008-09, in India, whatever future real estate development which was happening, 51% was residential and 49% was commercial. Out of that commercial, 50% was retail and 50% was office. In 2016, it's 85% residential, and out of the 15% commercial, it's again 85-15. So there's no retail supply coming in this country, and these things have a tendency to balance themselves out. So I don't know when these macros will balance themselves out, but they will 100% balance themselves out.
And the government has announced opening up of FDI in food and grocery retail. I think that can also be a big game changer, because once those guidelines are articulated and put out, if there are no other surprises there, then that will actually open up the way for some of the larger players who want to get into food and grocery retailing in India to start looking at it. And that possibly will spur some more interest in the sector.
Tara, the one question which every investor would like to know is, will the interest rates come down below the NOI yield or the cap rates that's being talked about? I mean, that's a struggle. In the mature markets, as you know, there is a arbitrage
difference between. If I could answer that question, I would be Mr. Raghuram Rajan's boss. So I don't think I'm going to say that.
Okay, another question. A mic, please, to the gentleman. So can you please introduce yourself and then
the question? Yes, my name is Nirmal Shah. I am from Ahmedabad. The reason I came to this conference was to kind of take a decision on whether I should set up a mall in Ahmedabad or not. And after hearing all of you guys, I'm still in a very confused state of mind. But that's my question is that if a developer is going to set up a mall, what is the way forward in terms of revenues, in terms of competition from e-commerce, in terms of the real estate scenario being the way it is? So if you can just shed some light on it.
Thank you so much for bailing us out.
So this question should be answered by me, not none of them. Because first you have to build, think about the city, think about the consumer, and if you're, if you believe the city, believe the consumer, and you have a great idea about a center or a social space, I would say, they will all come to you later on. So I think you don't need to ask this question to them. We'll answer
that's
it
right.
Offline.
Please build the mall, see your catchment, get the footfalls, get the revenues. We will just come.
I think
Rich will get us and we will come.
Sorry, but I'll put it differently. I think you should spend a lot more time planning out the whole thing and thinking through the whole thing before you go down and, you know, actually make that investment. So as he said, you know, you should be going to him or to any consultant in terms of first thinking through the whole thing and then only going ahead and making the investment.
A mall is a very capital intensive business, and having the expertise of mall management is a very important aspect. Also, you need to build it on paper, have financial closure before actually starting your construction. Otherwise, you can get caught on the wrong foot with a half-built mall with all your money invested and nowhere to go. So you got to be very cautious before you, you know, leap into actually building a shopping center.
So on the lighter tone, if it's going to be in Gujarat, I think your mall should have 90% food courts. Well, no, you'll be surprised. I know a lot of Jains, a lot of Gujaratis who go out and eat non-veg. So
a lot of F&B, but without the bars?
That the government decides. I mean, you and me don't decide on that. But food, 90% Gujarat mein ho jayega.
Another point is, and you know, there was a recent JLL statement which said that this year the sector will see increased investment, which is a positive thing. But the number that they said this year the market, you know, the market will see $80 million of investment. That's, Rahul, very disappointing, right? $80 million checked, you can just write. No, it's not the question to you, it's a general point. That seems to be too low, right? Probably they're talking of only one mall, and if you give an $80 million check to Nikhil, he's not going to do a transaction.
GIC already achieved that target, right, with Viviana. So that's done and dusted. Let's move away.
Any more questions?
We've got one here.
So you've been investing in global markets as well as in India.
Excuse
right?
me, just yeah. Can you please introduce yourself?
Sure, I'm Vineet. I'm still trying to learn retail sector in India. So I think that's where my question stems from. Right? All of you panelists have been investing in global markets as well as in India, right? And after listening to your discussions, I see two sets of buckets here. One definitely is the real estate developer, and second is the mall management company. Right? And mall management company is something which wherein there is a void in India, which is being driven by a lot of ecosystem around it, which you would potentially a science of how do you manage your tenant, the customer walk-ins, how much time it spends, et cetera, et cetera. So in terms of your views, how critical is that ecosystem? How long will India take to develop that ecosystem of mall management and the science behind it?
Nikhil or Bhardwaj, would you like to answer that?
No, I have a different answer for this. You know, basically the answer which everyone is giving is that mall management is a very tough business. Doesn't mean it doesn't exist in India. The guys who are players are actually doing it well. And I would give them a lot of respect for the way they are managing their centers. And if you see a lot of centers today in India, some of them are extremely successful even by international standards. The reason why you don't have those powerful centers like you have internationally is because we don't have that sort of tourism. We don't have, you know, people from home don't go and spend that sort of money every day. So let's say UK, London City attracts 200 million tourist visits per year. India attracts 7 million. So you need to understand the difference between these two. So mall management is good in India. Traffic is very poor in India. Second part of it, I'll just break up because a lot of people are, you know, skeptical about the investment climate in India. See, in India, what has happened is the risk involved with investments is extremely huge. Government ka permission nahi aaya, ye problem ho gaya, bagal mein kisi ne chalu kar diya, kisi ne aake aapke yahan bol diya ke boss, he's doing illegal, so you, they break one hammer on you. So that's why the IRR expectations are so high that now no one wants to come in only. They say, boss, this is not worth it only. I don't want to invest in this sector. There are three levels of this. One is the IRR when you start development. Second IRR is when you complete your center. Then 2 years more you need to have for stabilization. And the third is the stabilized IRR. Today in India, there's huge amount of money floating around for stabilized investments. There is no money for development risk, and there could be little money for stabilizing. That's because pricing is very difficult before stabilization. That's all. So that's where we are roaming around, and most of the people are satisfied. Once they have a large enough basket, you know, let's say you have 10 centers or 15 centers, you'll bring in all the mall managers from wherever you want and you'll be able to put them in.
Yeah, I do agree that mall management is important. But having said that, I think especially in India, we do face certain challenges. So in fact, in order to overcome this type of scenario, what we have done is we have created a private equity fund which is only for development aspect. That means they will buy land, they will complete it. Then there's one more private equity fund which comes and buy the income producing asset. So by doing so, what we are doing is we are segregating the risk so that the investors, whoever comes in any of this fund, will be able to actually know the risk and take their whatever risk appetite in that manner. Then by so that at least they will get the return what they were expecting. If we try to combine both together, I think it's going to be tough. So mall management definitely is the key. But having said that, you still need to evolve over time, because not only mall management, I think asset enhancement, those things also will be another key, because we need the customer in our mall. If we cannot get customers to our mall in day-to-day operation, it's going to be very, very tough. So that's the reason this retail asset class is a little bit different from when compared to other type of asset class. So we need a really a detailed plan before you get into a mall business.
So with that, we basically conclude this session. So very clearly, as is the case with most of the global investors, as they look at India, everybody is watching, everybody is interested. This sector has generated, you know, a good amount of initial interest. It needs to translate into a lot of activity, which it would. There is no reason why it would not. We all remain, as institutional investors, we all remain as cautiously but optimistic. So with that, we conclude this session. Thank you so much. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you very much, and a huge round of applause for our panelists.